Alright, no more excuses. Time to grit the teeth, clench the fist, and take one for the team. I'm talking about the World of Synnibarr. This is considered one of the worst role-playing games ever written. I've been reading it for 2 months now, and I can safely say this is not just one of the worst RPGs ever written, it's one of the worst things in the English language, regardless of format, ever written. It sits at number 2 on the worst RPG list behind the infamous Fatal, and I will say in Cinnabar's defense, at least it wasn't written by a rape fetishist, so that's why it's not the number 1 worst RPG of all time. But that's all I will say in its defense. So I've been trying to make sense of this monster for months now, and it's time to move on. I've got books piling up while I try to sort out this thing. So I'm Mr. Welch, and prepare for pain and suffering the likes of which you didn't think was possible. Prepare for the World of Cinnabar. For starters, let me explain what makes this book terrible. Everything. Everything makes this book terrible. Okay, maybe not the binding, it's a well-put-together book, but that's about it. The writing is tortured English, the game design is nonsensical, the art is uneven and often unpleasant to look at, the background makes no sense, the layout was done with a dartboard, editing was an afterthought, and the index is 8 pages long, and that's not including the sub-indexes. It reads like a quantum physics guide written by someone who learned everything about quantum physics from Doctor Who. This game would be absolutely gibberish to a new player. I'm a 30-year veteran of RPGs and it barely makes sense to me, and so this is what I've been dealing with for the last few months. Cinnabarr was released in 1980 by Wonderworld Press and written by Raven C.S. Little C.S. McCracken, with the more famous second edition hit in 1993, just in time for the grim dark darkness of the grim dark 90s. While this game was not grim dark, instead what it was indescribable. The world is destroyed by a werestorm, so a new god hollows out Mars, puts everybody from Earth inside of it, kicks Mars out of the solar system before the sun goes nova, where lots of people die in the process, everything mutates, aliens invade, and then nothing happens for the next 30,000 years. If I tried to put all of that in context, it would make even less sense than what I just said. Mechanically, the game is a class level system with a skill system tied inherently into character creation. Races are classes, I think, they weren't really clear on that. So among the 20 classes, you have psychic elves, dwarves, gnomes, giants, mutants, weremen, ninjas, archers, and biosynthesis cyborgs, among others, as possible options. You can take just the basic races without any training, so there's the dwarf race and the dwarf class. The races have to spend money to raise their attributes, while the classes get expertise points, which is just XP. Character creation is super easy. Roll 7d20, drop the two lowest, re-roll the two lowest rolls that were left over, and you can't roll less than the lowest remaining die after that, and put the results into the stats you want. If you can roll all 20s on the dice, you become an immortal. And lucky you for rolling a feat with a possible chance of just over 1 in 3 million. Be sure to hand over your dice to the GM, who I am really sure is going to want to look at them with an electron microscope. So for the other 2,999,999 of us who didn't become gods on character creation, you have to pick from the remaining 20 character classes. Your options include soulless bio-engineered cyborgs, psychic space elves, man-sized dragons with all the benefits, superhuman martial artists, techno-giants, and a guy who is good with a longbow. Everybody say hi to Hawkeye. Your stats go from 5 to 50, with the exception of ego, which goes up to 100, intelligence caps at 30, and strength, which maxes out at 1500. So that's a bit of a balance issue there. Just a bit. Once that's done, you get to roll for random mutations, psionics, and all your physical traits. You don't get to pick those. Rolling is mandatory. And the game clearly states in the rules you are not allowed to change the rules. If you do, you get penalized. Especially if you're the game master. So you roll your gender, racial type, hair color, eye color, handedness, height, weight, appearance, and age, and then your character is somewhat done. Then roll for starting cash, which can be anything from a grand to a million, unless you roll double aught, in which case you get 1d4 million because you're rich. Or on the second roll, if you can get an 86 or higher, your parent is a god, in which case you get 1d6 times $100. Oh, and an all-powerful artifact. Lucky you. You're probably the guy that rolled all 20s on your character creation. Then you pick your alignment, I mean aura, from the 9 options, which are super secret, and you're not allowed to write them down on your character sheet, despite there being a spot for it. And that's the first easy-to-follow step for character creation, bringing us to page 32 in a 478-page rulebook. And we have so much more to talk about. Oh, quit screaming. I suffered through this just as much as you. Here, look at lovely Winona for a few minutes to recover. She'd want you to stay strong. This book can't hurt you. Well, actually, it can. The thing is a brick. It's almost 500 pages in length and would probably be half that if a decent editor got their hands on it. There was supposed to be a third edition that was successfully kickstarted years ago, but that was never shipped. And then last year, McCracken posted up pictures of the final copies, and they were botched badly by the printer and couldn't be released. So the game's fate remains uncertain. Okay, better now? Witness the calming powers of Miss Ryder, the dewy-eyed goddess. Now back to the review. Once you pick your class, then you get to decide on alternate races, and there's a few dozen of those, including mutant vampires, giant elementals, lotmen, that's lot with two T's, who have multiple forms and absolutely no description of what they're supposed to be. There's a physical description in the back of the book, but that doesn't tell you anything remotely what they're supposed to look like. I mean, if I told you the race was typically 4'10", extremely hairy, and known for being quite surly, am I supposed to be describing lots or dwarves? Okay, I was actually describing Danny DeVito, but my point stands. That's another problem. Nothing in this book is explained to you. Do you want to play an earth lot or an ice lot? What's the difference? Well, one is 8 feet taller than the other, but you wouldn't know that unless you turn to page 400 in the back of the book to find out. Of course, it doesn't tell you on page 22 to turn to page 400, so good luck there. Then you've got alternate races like the Priests of Berevia, which are mentioned in the geography section, but never really expounded upon, ever. Skipping a bit, because I can make an hour video just what's wrong with the first 30 pages. Now I know how Joel and the bots felt watching Manos, the Hands of Fate, except I don't get any help riffing this book. Next up is skill selection. And there's a lovely selection of skills with no purpose, no explanation, and no balance. You got your standard combat abilities like combat dodging, combat advanced weapons, combat martial arts, and combat practitioner of the magic arts. You've also got skills for being a mime, a basket weaver, and into cinematography. You also pick a hobby with an open-ended list that includes croquet, body painting, and yo-yo throwing. Then you apply any racial bonuses and you're good to go. So if you're an archer, you get a plus 25 chance to hit with your bow, and a minor spell that lets you conjure arrows. If you're a talking raccoon, you get enhanced senses and a 25% chance to hit with a ranged weapon that's not a longbow. And if you pick a warlot, you get spell detection, 2 extra attacks, reduce all damage by 99%, and have a 25% chance of a major mutation. So as you can see, it's totally balanced. Then you start to level up and follow the easy, massive character chart explaining everything you gain each level. Once you hit level 45, you have to petition to become an immortal, unless you're already immortal. If your parent is a god that was established in rolling your starting cash, then you get a head start. You get an extremely difficult quest, and if you succeed, you become level 51 and you're an immortal. Now the fun starts, because while mortals were capped at a measly level 50, you can go all the way to level 600, making you a 50th level god. You get tons more advantages, like the learning Vulcan nerve pinches, new mutations, permanent spells, wishes, massive damage resistance, and even bonus engineering degrees. When you get to gear, the game gives you the basic breakdown of the economy, then explains to players that at level 40, they can create money with their matter creation powers. Then it says that the Terra Council calls all 40th level adventurers to discuss with them the fact that that ability will destroy the economy of the planet in no time flat, and they should be very careful in using their abilities. And then the player characters ignore that ability because they are 40th level characters in Synnibarr, and they've just spent hours reading up the Juggernaut class power armor with over 2 billion with a B hit points and enough firepower to bring down moons, and they see that $265 million price tag, and what do you think they're going to do? They are going to ruin the economy faster than Speedy Gonzales on a Jolt Cola bender. There's a lot to buy for starting gear, and only some of it doesn't break the game in new and interesting ways. For fun, replace 15% of your meat with Body Mod 2. For $26 million, you get 10,000 hit points and a 10% damage reduction. For $27 million, you get 60,000 hit points and 99% damage reduction. Go all the way for $126 million for a cool 4 million hit points and 10,000% damage reduction. Or just remember that the cybernetic hit points that you buy are added to your hit point total, so you spend $1,000 on a cryogenic power cable that inserts into your body, and that grants you 5,000 hit points to start at level 1. There's transports ranging from pedal-powered gyrocopters to starships that can one-shot Death Stars. There's pages of new material that only contradict each other's in the next chart on weight, rarity, and cost. The weapons showcase the high-powered nature of the game. The worst weapon in the game, the Humble Dagger, does 1d4 times 100 damage plus strength. This game just took D&D stats and multiplied everything by 100 to make it more powerful. This is also where you find the Pelium Shot for Slings, which is a $1 bullet weighing 2.7 pounds, where another chart in the same system points out that Pelium costs $1,000 per ounce. So, go for the discount. Screw the economy. You've got to go to the big guns because the big armor will make everything that doesn't do tens or hundreds of thousands of points of damage moot. Everything in Synnibarr is ridiculously over the top. Cops in the City of Terror drive Lamborghini hover cars. Everything cool has at least 100,000 hit points or more. It's a strange mix of fantasy, superheroes, science fiction, and horror, and succeeds at none of them. It talks about all the various lands in Synnibarr and gives a detailed yet completely pointless guide to the City of Terror. There's no sense of economy, balance, or basic comprehension. It's just chart after chart of random numbers. It reads like somebody who wrote this when they were 9 and playing with all the random action figures they had in their toy box. Combat is a nightmare of dueling rolls. You roll a percentile to hit, and then you make a dodge roll. If that fails, you can make a fate roll. If that fails, and the damage was enough to kill you, you make a god roll. There's 4 categories of surprise. There are some attacks that are almost impossible to dodge because they are so fast they're called beam attacks. That makes perfect sense until you realize one of the core abilities of the ninja is that the ninja counts as a beam attack. The class itself turns all attacks into beam attacks. Throw a rock? Beam attack. Stab with a dagger? Beam attack. Smacks you with a pillow at your sleepover? Beam attack. Never get into a pillow fight with a ninja. You're not going to win. Quick, more Winona. My eyes are bleeding at this point. It's hard to describe how complicated this game is. There's multiple forms of magic, each going to 50th level in spells, even though they do skip over a lot of the levels. There's level 40 and level 50 spells, but there's no level 43 spell, for example. The spell's abilities need a slide roll to figure out. For example, the drain on the ninja for the Tuch, T-U-C-H, spell is once per day, per 10 levels, but no more than 10 uses per day, plus a quarter of the victim's constitution score that's above your own score. You can't use this power on creatures over 10 tons in weight, but you can increase that limit by 2 tons per 1 level over your ninja levels that's over 10th. Got it? Simple. Now, imagine hundreds of spells like this. My personal favorite was the Mage Warrior spell Power Transfer, which permanently steals another character's, well, everything. All their XP, their abilities, their spells, their powers, their class. You cast this on a 50th level ninja, and now you're a Mage Warrior and a 50th level ninja. You can only cast this spell twice successfully as a mortal. But once you level up as an immortal, you gain more uses. Fun times indeed. Unless you were playing that 50th level ninja and you're back down to level 0 with no powers at all. Combat and movement is again overly complicated. At one point, it has you calculate the square root of some variables to come up with the time moved if you are not decelerating. The time is the square root of 8 times the distance in feet moved divided by your movement rate. I hope you paid attention in algebra. The funniest part is the previous line that says, "Don't worry about looking up the chart on page 211. Use this easier calculation." And again, this is from the 90s. We didn't have supercomputers on our phones yet. There's a ton of modifiers like that. To calculate your actual speed at time of arrival is done by simply dividing your movement rate by 2.933, then multiplying that by the time moved. To calculate swimming acceleration, it's movement rate times 8, times that by 56, and add 14 to that, then divide by 293.33. At this point in the game, Stephen Hawking would will himself the strength to pick up the book and throw it at you. I would describe to you how to calculate faster than light transitions, but as soon as you saw the scientific notation required, I figure you'd start looking for that 10-hour video of bears dancing to Sweet Dreams instead. Speaking of bears, I would be remiss not to mention that all the monsters in Synnibarr have some sort of magical or psychic or mutant attack. That means panda bears are now 30 feet tall and can use the psychic power Intellect Annihilation. Giant sea polar bears only stand 25 feet tall, but they can turn invisible and can crush you to death with telekinetic bear hugs. And of course, sea bears have freaking laser beams they shoot from their eyes, and those are the normal bears. The giant flying grizzly adds wings to the mix, as well as the ability to shoot giant freaking laser beams out of their eyes. And don't forget the giant sunstone grizzlies, which are impossible to miss because they're 100 feet tall and weigh 200 tons. They also have 1,000,000 hit points and 10,000% damage reduction. You've got 500-pound, 4-foot-long armadillos with porcine tails that can destroy your mind like the pandas can, and they shoot poison spines at you. On the other hand, they are quite tasty as per the rules. There's the giant mutant fire clam, which weighs up to 4 tons and reaches 15 feet in diameter. They have multiple fire attacks that they can prepare in advance because they can automatically detect all life forms in 200 feet. You've got dragons and drakes, both of which can destroy a party, unless the party has billions of hit points and reduces all damage by 10,000% round down. McCracken must have had a hard-on for drakes because there's 7 pages of them. Then you've got the hydras. There's only 3 pages of hydras, but the Midnight Sunstone hydras get 12 heads, and each one of those hydras is immortal and have absolutely kick-ass names. Like the Emperor Lord Midnight Hydra, the Empress Shadarla Hydra, Armory Trina, Darx Apprentice Hydra, and Drum the Rouge. That's not a typo. At least I think it's not a typo. You know what? At this point, I'm past caring about typos. His name is Drum the Rouge. There's a 72-headed Hydra probably still running around somewhere that was mentioned in the introduction. I have to skip forward. This game is a trap. Once you start looking at the insanity of just one chapter, it draws you in for hours. The Necronomicon costs less insanity to read than the World of Synnibarr. You want whacked out monsters? Knock yourself out. There's a half-leopard, half-shark hybrid. The monster entry for the local cop takes up a full page in length, compared to a couple of paragraphs for the largest dragon. Rocket Raccoon is on page 411. He came out in 1976. This book first came out in 1980, so it's pretty obviously him. There's temporal were-wraiths to fight, among other types of wraiths, and there's just pages and pages of more random nightmare fuel. If you thought the monsters weren't powerful enough, hang out with the gods. There's tons of pages on them as well. There's Sapel, father of all gods. Cat, god of thieves. Shernoclasp Teptor, the infester. Ring Zazarak, Razad, god of death. Job, god of nullifications. And Sheila the beautiful, goddess of love, who appears as the woman of your dreams. She takes love very seriously. She was passion incarnate, given to indulgence with anyone she takes a fancy to, even mortals. I'm reading this entry word for word. This is getting really creepy. God, I hope the real Sheila, whoever she was, never found this book and randomly flipped to page 444. But that's the end of the World of Synnibarr. Our long national nightmare is over. I did it. I reviewed the second worst RPG of all time. I feel like all my sins have been burned away as my penance is complete. There's almost nothing redeemable about this game. It's needlessly complicated. The rules make no sense. It's hard to follow. There's no sense of balance starting with page one. The number range is pointlessly inflated just so you'd have huge numbers. The game throws around billions of anything as a mechanic. It's time to put the pencil down. Ain't nobody got time to calculate the square root of anything at a gaming table. Remember, this was written in 1980, and remember that the TI-30 came out just 4 years prior. So you can thank Texas Instruments for making this game feasible in the first place. So yeah, this is all Texas Instruments' fault. If you want a copy, first, what the hell is wrong with you? It was $30 sticker price then when second edition came out. Most copies on eBay sell for about $20 just for nostalgia value. There's a campaign guide that you can get around for base price. Or you can spend that money and go to the zoo. Check out some community theater. They're always showing something new and they could use your support. Donate to the local animal shelter and feel better about yourself immediately. Grab a copy of Welcome Home Roxy Carmichael and you lose yourself in those doughy eyes. There's so many better ways to spend $20, but I'm going to cleanse my palate because I've got RPGs piled up to review, and the one sitting on top of the stack is an oldie but a goldie, Bard Games Arcanum. No, not the steampunk game that everybody remembers fondly, but then is utterly disappointed by because of the lack of balance and the nonsensical plot, but the D&D clone that came out back when D&D was new. It had some interesting ideas, but it was a bit limited in scope. So until then, remember, at least this game wasn't written by a rape fetishist.